Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How many of you are glad that you're born again?
Woo! Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, indeed.
Boys, how many of you, let me ask you this question too. How many of you would have never thought you would have ever said, thank you, Jesus, back in the day? You remember?
Yeah.
You never thought you'd have been in a church, especially on a Thursday night. You know what I mean? But here you are, praising the Lord. Isn't it wonderful? Let me tell you something. You know, you hear a lot about the cross, but you know that in early Christianity, that's what was mentioned. We mentioned the cross. You know, it's the gospel of Jesus Christ where we put our faith, right? The gospel. But you know, the word gospel throughout the years has been watered down so much that when you say cross, people identify that with what Christ accomplished.
Amen.
It sticks out. It offends people. It strikes you because it's an offense, meant to be an offense. So when we talk about the cross, listen, you know, it's good to be in this church. Let me tell you right now, because I know Matt preaches the cross.
Amen.
Christ crucified. And tonight, I'll break it down to you so you can understand this a little bit even better, maybe. I don't know. Matt does such a good job, so. But I'll try. But my goal is for you to see the sufficiency in what Christ has accomplished for you. Do you realize that there's nothing that pertains to your life and godliness that you have to try to, through your own efforts, to produce?
Praise God.
Amen. That's an amen statement. It's a good spot for you to shout amen.
Yeah.
Because what Jesus Christ did, he did it for you already.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? He's already accomplished for you what you could never do. And everything you have need of in this life, he's already provided.
Thank you, Lord.
What about healing? Provided.
Provided.
Sound mind? Provided. Power? Provided.
Come on.
Finances? Provided. Anything else you can think of? Provided. And what was your responsibility?
Just believe.
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 So, isn't that good news?
Amen.
Well, that's the gospel. Man, y'all have to get a little bit more lively than that. I'm going to be trained up here, man.
Come on.
Glory. Hallelujah. Turn in your Bibles. Turn in your Bibles with me to Colossians. And we're going to be reading in the first chapter. Chapter 1, verse 20 through 23. Now, I'm just going to kind of give you a little heads up. If you're trying to take notes, you know, make sure you got a spare pencil, spare pen, because I'm going to be all over the place, right? Just to give you a heads up. Okay. And it says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, he has now yet reconciled, in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Okay, now I want to stop right there for just a second. Alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked work, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Now, there's two aspects of the cross of Christ that I want to mention to you tonight. Number one, there's the death side. Number two, there's the life side. Okay. Does everybody agree with this based out of Romans chapter 6? That you were crucified with Christ the moment you got The moment you believed, the moment you repented, and you called on Jesus, and the Holy Spirit came in, you got born again, what happened to you? In an instant, you were assimilated into Christ, right?
Amen.
Into his death, into his burial, into his resurrection. So just as Christ was crucified, you were crucified with him. Am I right?
Amen.
Right.
Okay. So you were crucified with Christ. So that's co-death. You were co-crucified with Christ. Then you were buried with him. Am I right?
Right. Okay.
So that's co-burial. Then you were co-raised with him. Not co-raised, but co-raised with him. Meaning that just as he was risen from the dead, you were risen with him to walk in newness of life. Sad thing about Christians today is that we go to the death part of the cross. We come through repentance. We get born again, right? The old man is crucified with Christ. But we fail to follow through to the resurrection life. Because we don't understand the cross. Let me digress a little bit. How many of you remember the day you got born again? Mm-hmm. You remember how fresh it was. You remember that how that all your burdens were lifted. Your sin, your guilt, your shame was taken from you. And you just felt love. You felt forgiven. You felt new. You became a new creation, right? Holy Spirit came in. It made you alive. And then you were so glad because of all the things you were bound to, all the things you used to do. Man, it's over now, right? Is that what you were thinking? Man, this is over. No more am I ever going to be in bondage to this. No more. That old person is gone. Hallelujah. I remember when I first got saved, the first thing I tried to do was say hallelujah. I mean, I thought it was the strangest word, you know? Try to be lost and say hallelujah. It's like hallelujah. But when I got saved, I got born again. I ran outside. I looked at the sky. It was bluer than it's ever been. Then all of a sudden, I said hallelujah. Oh, I said, man, it feels so good. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I was just, hallelujah. I was hallelujah, man.
Hallelujah.
So, hallelujah. But you remember how you felt. Now, it wasn't too much longer after that you actually sinned, right? So how did you feel when you sinned against God?
Condemned.
Especially if you did something you said you would never do again because you got born again.
Convicted.
Conviction. Yeah, big time, huh? How much guilt and how much shame flooded your soul? How long did it take for you to really feel or receive the refreshing from the Lord? Took a while, right? Like maybe a couple of days. It was like, even when you see another Christian, you'd be like, what's going on? It's all good. Praise the Lord. Something the matter? Oh, no, man. Well, I'm all right. You know, I just got something in my eyes. So, you know, just, you know. Right? Because of the guilt. But then after a while, you start reading that, you start praying, and all of a sudden, you feel the refreshing once again. And then what's the first thing you say? Say, oh, thank you, Jesus, right? Oh, Lord, hallelujah. I'm never going to go back to that again. Right?
Thank you, Jesus.
Then what's the next thing out of your mouth? This is how I'm not going to go back there again. So in other words, what you've just done was, through that series of repentance, you found yourself back under the grace of God, under the government of God's grace, where there was peace and joy. The Holy Spirit moving and operating in you. Right? You're supposed to continue that way.
Amen.
You're supposed to live like that. That's the resurrection. That's the power of life through the cross. You got the cleansed, you're new. Now you're resting in that finished work, and now you live in that peace. You have your life and being in that peace. You follow what I'm saying so far?
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that we get there and we freeze frame right there when you receive that refreshing from the Lord. That confirmation that he just puts in your soul, I'm right with him again. You know, my sin's been forgiven, I cleansed, it's in my mind, I know it, I'm assured of it, I just know that, you know, now I'm back on track and I'm not going to sin again. But then yet, you begin to formulate a regimen of works. I'm not going to sin again because I'm going to read my Bible even more. I'm going to wake up an extra hour in the morning. No, you know what? I'm going to wake up 2 hours early in the morning, and I'm going to pray for an hour and read my Bible for an hour, and I dare not put any morsel of food in my mouth until I've had the bread of life.
Amen.
See, y'all amen, but y'all should be amen, because that's works.
Amen. That's how you work it.
That's my amen corner. They'll be over there getting warmed up. But you see what I'm saying? What happens is that we formulate rules and regulations and laws that produce nothing for you but misery. Because there's no power. There's no power in the law to deliver you from darkness.
Right.
There's no power in the law to make you right with God. Listen, you're not going to get more holy by reading more Bible. You're going to get holy by putting faith in what Christ accomplished.
Praise God.
Amen.
Did you catch that?
Amen.
But we've gone into this, we came out of the kingdom of darkness and were translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Right? We were brought into the kingdom of light. But when we came into God's kingdom, we came in with a wrong mindset. See, when the world looks at Christians as people who are perfect, they don't sin, right? They're good people, and they're right with God. Now, how many people ever come to you and say, oh, you're a Christian, right? Yeah. You say, well, can you lift up a prayer for me? Can you send the big guy upstairs a prayer for me? I'm like, no, I can't do that. Who's the big guy upstairs? You know, and they'd be like, well, you know God. I mean, God. You know, surely you know God, so can you say something good for me? Nah. I can't say anything good for you. Why not? It wouldn't do no good. I mean, he gave you Jesus Christ. What else you want? I mean, go to him. Go to Jesus and he'll take care of this for you. But I can't pray for you. I mean, I'll pray for you to come to Jesus, but I'm not going to just, hey, God, can you consider this guy over here? You know, this wretched sinner that rejects your Son? Are you serious? That was a side joke. Okay, anyway.
That wasn't funny.
No. All right. Getting back on track. I chase these little rabbits every once in a while. You have to excuse me. But now, what happens is we come into this kingdom with this mindset that I have to earn something from God. That I got to do something, and if I do something, God's going to do something on my behalf. That's our mindset. That's Old Covenant mindset, by the way. Old Covenant mindset that you have to do something to earn God's approval. Right? I got to keep the law. I got to do the requirements so that I can be approved or I can meet God. Okay. You're not in Old Covenant. You're right. In New Covenant.
Amen.
Amen.
Right?
Right.
So God's already done everything for you. All you have to do is rest in what he's accomplished. Now, let's go back to the scenario where you just got born again and then you just sinned against God and you set up this regimen of works, what you were going to do. Well, I'm going to pray, I'm going to fast, I'm going to do all these other things. Well, what happens when you get yourself back under the government of law? Do y'all understand what I'm talking about when I say government of law and government of grace? Do y'all understand that?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure y'all do, right? This church, okay. If you don't, for those maybe watching that don't know what it is, the government is something that you rule yourself by. It's something that you live by. A system of rules, right? Or a government that kind of governs how you live. Under law, law is don't do this, don't do this, do that, don't do this. If you do this, you're in good shape. If you don't do it, you're in bad shape. The curse of the law of sin and death. You break the law, you die. Okay? There's nothing there in the law that produces life. It's death. The Holy Spirit brings life.
Amen.
That's the government of God's grace. And God's grace is the movement and the operation of the Holy Spirit in your life.
Amen.
Every day, based upon your faith in Christ and what He's accomplished on Calvary. So what happens is you have access into this grace through faith. Now, I'm sure you've heard that too, right? Romans 5, 1 and 2. So you have grace, you have access into this grace through your faith. Faith in what? Faith in what Christ has accomplished. What did He accomplish? Through the body of His flesh. Look at it right here in verse 23 or 22 of Colossians 1. In the body of His flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in God's sight. So your condition or your position in Christ Jesus is that of holy, unblameable, and unreprovable.
Come on.
So what are you trying to earn? What are you trying to do? You follow what I'm saying? So if I'm holy and unblameable and unreprovable in the sight of God for doing nothing but just simply believing on Jesus Christ, then why must I try to earn God's approval? I don't have to do anything to be holy because God made me holy. He called me holy. Right?
Right.
Amen.
God declared me holy, innocent of all sin, justified me. That's my position in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So now that frees me from having to try to earn righteousness or holiness.
Amen.
I don't have to do that anymore. I don't have to be bound by works. But what happens if I mess up? What happens? Okay, let me define victorious living in Christ Jesus for you. Number one, let me tell you what it's not. It's not sinless perfection. It's not sinless perfection. But it's consistently putting faith in what Christ has accomplished, His finished work. Consistently putting faith there. Consistently drawing from that well, from that spring of life. Consistently going there for your every need. Consistently
Amen.
Going there. Consistently going there. You get the picture? Consistently going there.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like this. Picture, you know, like you're on a deserted island somewhere and you're looking for some water to drink. And there's really no good water to drink. You have all this salt water and there's some other little pieces, you know, after it rains, maybe you can collect some water to drink. But you're thirsty and you need water to survive. So you start to search all over the island and you find this spring of water. It's fresh water. You can drink it. And it's like a never-ending supply, it seems. And so you gather up all the water you can and you go back to your little camp. Problem is, you forgot where the spring was. You knew the spring was out there, but you forgot where it is. So then you start searching all over again. Is it here? Is it there? Is it under behind this rock? Is it over that hill? Is it behind this tree? That's what many people do today. See, we've got born again and we drank from the water, the living waters, but we don't know where it is. And so we go around looking for it all the time. Devising programs and devising systems and methods and what I call trends and, you know, all these different fads in the church to try to find the well.
Come on.
But when somebody brings you to the well or shows you where it's at, hence the preaching of the cross. People who teach the message of the cross and begin to share it with you. You learn from them and then you just don't be a hearer only, but be a doer of the word.
Amen.
Amen.
Exercise this. You know, practice it. Put effort into it and follow Christ by faith, not by works. Dependency, confidence, trust, and what Christ accomplished. Now watch this. Back to the deserted island. Once you find where the well is, and you know how to get there, what happens every time that you need something? Well, okay, I need this. Well, I go to the well. 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 What begins to happen? There's a path that begins to form. That path begins to form. So now I could walk to the well without even really paying attention where I'm going, because I'm walking the path that goes to the well. So I'm consistently drawing from the well. That's victorious Christian living.
Amen.
See, but we have this wrong mindset that we have to be perfect. And if I make a mistake, then I got to start over again. And then we get desperate. And then we abandon faith in the cross and pick up some other kind of regimen. Some other kind of trend. See? And then let me chase another little rabbit right here. Dealing with the message of the cross. You know, and I may have mentioned it just a second ago, but there's a lot of people who have a mental, intellectually, you know, processed the message of the cross, where they can teach other people. They can tell it to, you know, if you ask them, what is the message of the cross? Oh, blah, blah, blah. You know, put your faith in Jesus Christ, message of Christ crucified. Man, you can talk the talk, man, all day long. You can teach people. You can show them in the scriptures where it's at. But in your daily living, you don't live it. Man, it's quiet in this place. You're not living it.
Come on.
Why?
Frustrating the grace of God.
Frustrating the grace of God. Because see, you might not realize it, but you're trying to obtain righteousness through your works. You're not resting in this truth that I just read to you in the 22nd verse of Colossians chapter 1. Watch this. Colossians 2:10. What does it say? And you are complete in who? Christ. In Him, which is the head of all principality and power. See, we don't think that we're complete. You know what complete means? Full. I'm full. I don't need any more. There's nothing more that needs to be done. I'm finished. The work that Christ accomplished on Calvary is complete. And you are complete in Him.
Amen.
There's no more work that needs to be done for your sanctification, for your righteousness, for your holiness, for your justification. Now you can rest in that finished work and realize that I'm holy because God made me holy and because of my faith in what Christ accomplished. But now, here it is. I have to live my life. So how do I live my life? Right? The resurrection side. Now that I was raised with Christ Jesus, I'm to walk in the newness of life. So how do I walk? Well, that's simple. Read 2, 6, and 7 of Colossians. As you therefore have received Him, so walk in Him. Rooted and built up in Him, established in the what? In the faith. What's the faith?
Faith.
Christ crucified.
Faith.
What Christ accomplished. The gospel. The message of the cross. Realizing that what took place in Colossians 1:22 is a settled thing. That is finished. I'm complete in Him. And now I'm walking in this truth. Resting. So that means now that I don't have to try to perform for holiness anymore because I'm holy. I don't have to try to be righteous because I am. Not because of what I do, but because of what Christ did and my faith in that work.
Amen.
Amen.
God imputes righteousness unto me. Now, for my daily living, my sanctified, you know, the sanctification process, this progressive work of the Holy Spirit, He's working now in me to conform me into the image of His Son, in the image of Jesus Christ. So I'm being molded and conformed. So now, if I realize, now bear with me, I may not be, I'm not Matt Hebert, so I'm not going to be using all these big words and all that stuff. But listen. So if I am already holy, then I don't have to worry about that part of my life anymore. I don't have to worry about how God sees me anymore. Because I'm confident, I'm resting, I'm persuaded, fully persuaded in what Christ accomplished is sufficient for me to be holy in front of God, in God's sight. So I don't have to earn it anymore. But now my life and living over here now, how I treat people, how I live, how I do things. Now this is dependent upon one thing, my faith in that word.
Come on.
And let me explain to you. Because I don't have to worry about being holy. All I'm worried about now is allowing the Holy Spirit to change me.
Yeah.
To change this.
Amen.
This my show me, Lord. Give me desires, Lord. Produce in me. See, Philippians 2:13, is that right? For it is God that worketh in you to will and to do His good pleasure. Work in me, Lord. Produce your will in me. Give me the ability. See, now I realize in my life, it's maturity in Christ, I guess what it amounts to, but now I realize that I don't have to do anything to earn something from God, but that's already been given to me as a gift. But now I have the opportunity to allow the Holy Spirit to change me.
Amen.
Is that right? Do you see that work?
Amen.
So now He can change me. And I don't have to interfere or frustrate the grace of God anymore. I don't have to interfere with the Holy Spirit's work in my life anymore. Because I realized I don't need to be holy. I don't need to make myself holy. I am holy. Now, my condition is something I can't fix, so now the Holy Spirit's got to fix me.
Amen.
He that began a good work in you will complete it until the day of the Lord.
Amen.
So, are you with me so far?
Yes.
Let's go back to the two sides of the cross. So I told you I was going to jump around.
That's all right.
The death side of the cross. This is where many Christians, everybody has to go here, okay? First of all, you cannot be saved until you die in Christ. You got to go to the cross first. Without that, you have no life. Right? So, you before you could be ever be born again, you're going to have to die on the cross. That's what it is. You'll have to realize that you've sinned against God. Anyway, you go to the cross. Through repentance and faith, you're converted. Born again. After that, you've entered into God's grace. Because at that moment, see, there's the peace of God. He's reigning in your heart. The Holy Spirit's reigning in your life. He's producing His will in you. Right? Man, this is the life. Oh, sinned. Now I got to go back. Make the big circle. Come back and repent one more time. Go through this 3 or 4 day stage of being ashamed. And then finally, you know, it dawns on me, okay, God loves me and God's forgiven me and whatever, whatever. I can look at people again. Now I'm going to, I enter back into God's grace, allowing His Holy Spirit is so good, I can worship God again, you know, I'm just so wonderful. It's just a wonderful life. Oh God, I'm never going to sin again. So to make sure I do that, I'm going to join the church's witnessing committee or whatever. You know what I mean? You're going to do something. You're going to do some kind of work. Well, you just left grace and went back to law. That was short-lived. Here we go. Roller coaster ride again. So, the life side of the cross is where you do nothing. It's where you rest in what has already been accomplished. I know I've said it once, twice, 3 times already, but you need to hear it more than that, because we don't get it. Some of you might even leave out of here, say, man, wow, okay, maybe something I said might have, brought some light on something. 2 days later, you'll be right back doing the same thing again. Share a little testimony. Working in the prisons, and I was ministering there. In my ministry, we cast out devils. We've seen the sick healed. We've seen people baptized with the Holy Spirit, radical conversions. I mean, just tremendous work. I mean, people, it's incredible. I mean, you can see a man that is definitely demon-possessed come into a service, and then all of a sudden the gospel's preached and his heart is pricked, and that devil is cast out of him. And from this, I remember this one guy who must have been like 6'6", 6'7", something like this. Big guy. Hairy dude, man. Hairy. Hair, come on. Oh, hairy, man. Oh, and mean looking. Somebody you would not want to meet in the alley. I mean, looked like a big grizzly bear. I mean, seriously. And that guy came in to that service, and I told one of the other volunteers, I said, you see that guy? Jesus is going to save him tonight. And he said, oh, I don't know about all that. Sure enough, by the end of that service, that man was crying on my shoulder. Saw him a year later, didn't even recognize him. Serving the Lord. Baptized with the Holy Ghost.
Praise God.
And that's just one story. I could go on and on all night long telling you about these things.
God is good.
But in my personal life, this is before I knew the cross, before I understood what Christ accomplished for me. And so I understood the way to victory. I didn't understand it those days. So I found that in my ministry, I depended on the Holy Spirit greatly to be able to do these things. And it's like I operated under God's grace. I was in God's grace. I was ministering. It was so real. The Holy Spirit could just say something, and I knew exactly what he was. And we just operate. Man, things happened. It was wonderful. But my personal life, I would cry out to God and say, why is it so hard to live for you? If you knew what my regimen of living was, sometimes 6 to 8 hours of prayer on a Saturday morning or a Sunday morning, sitting on my face before God praying. And don't get me wrong, I had some incredible times with the Lord. Sometimes I thought I was just going to die and be raptured up right there. It was incredible. But I had no, after this time that I spent with the Lord, it was like the presence faded, the glory faded. That's why we have so many people in churches today, the only victory they get is on Sunday morning worship service. The only time they have victory is when they come together and congregate and have fellowship, because this is the only time that they can really let loose and worship God. Because while they're doing that, they're forgetting that, they're just worshiping the Lord and they feel the presence of God, the Holy Spirit and all this. But when they get back out and go back through those doors and start and go home, they're right back under the bondage of law. Living in misery. Now, I want to put one other thing to you. Well, let me finish with my testimony, then I'm going to bring this out. How are we doing on time? Am I 2 hours yet? No.
Plenty.
Okay. So I would cry out to God, how do I live? How do I live? Why can I live victoriously? Why am I still struggling? Why is it so hard? Then he took me to Galatians chapter 3. It says, foolish Galatians, right? Who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was evidently set forth crucified among you? This only I want to learn from you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith?
Come on.
Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect through your flesh? Cut my heart. I was like, what? Your answer, son, is in the cross of Christ. The cross of Christ. Jesus Christ and Him crucified is your answer. You know what He did? Do you know what Jesus did for you? Really? You know, anybody seen the Passion of the Christ? I'm pretty sure a lot of people have. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you get a pretty good picture of what happened there, but it's actually a little worse than that. They take Him to the whipping post and they strip His clothes off of Him. And they have these whips, these lictor's lashes, or I guess some people call them cat of nine tails or whatever. But these little whips, and they had strips of leather on them. And on the little strips of leather, they'd have these little steel balls and pieces of sheep bone and whatever else they'd had on there. And they'd tie them on there, and they'd whip you. They'd have your hands tied around this thing so you couldn't move. And then they'd whip you, and it would just bruise the flesh and then... And this shred the flesh. And in Isaiah 52, the end of Isaiah 52, it says that Jesus' countenance was marred more than any other man. It actually means this. It means that he was so disfigured you couldn't even call him a man. That was just the beating he endured. Every piece of his flesh quivering, the nerves shaking in his whole body. And then they make him carry this cross member, this cross beam for his cross, up to Golgotha's hill. Already they had plucked the beard from his face. I think it's in Isaiah 50. 50 and verse 6, it says that he turned his back to them and let him pull the hair out of his face.
Right.
They punched him. They took a crown of thorns and stuck it on his head and beat him with a staff, putting those things through his brow. His face swollen up. His body just bleeding from everywhere, mixed with sweat, mixed with spit and dirt. Brutal beating. They put a robe on him and beat him with reeds and calling him king. Then they brought him to the people. Here's this man. What do you want to do with him? Crucify him. His own people. The ones that he came to save. The ones that he came and helped. The Bible says there was not a vile word in his mouth. He did nothing wrong. He was without sin. But yet we had such hatred in our hearts. Sin, corruption, our sin, their sin. That's how evil men can be. Then they crucified him on a cross, nailed his hands and feet, stuck him up there, couldn't breathe. And he had to push his weight upon his feet because his legs are bent like this, and he's sitting there on the cross and he's got to pick his feet up, and every time he does, his back rubs against that cross, and he's already weak, been up all night, been beaten all day. And he's on this cross and he winds up paying the penalty in full for our sins. The Bible says that in Isaiah 53 that he bore our sorrows and carried our griefs. Or it might be vice versa. I can't remember. It says that he was for our iniquities. He was, well, let me just put it in my own words. He was beaten so bad that what he accomplished for us was to take that burden that we owed, the wages of our sin. He received it upon himself. Let me just kind of give you a little thing. In the Hebrew, the word for bore, where, and I think it's in the fourth verse, where it says that he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. That word bore and carried, they're synonyms in the Hebrew. The word bore there is nasa, and the word carried is sabal. Both mean the same thing, almost. But the word picture is that somebody takes a burden off of you and bears the punishment of your burden so you won't have to bear it. And the word griefs and sorrows there is sickness and disease, infirmities and maladies of your body. And it's interesting to note that in the last verse of that chapter, Isaiah 53, he says that he may bear the sins of many. Same word, nasa. So what Jesus Christ did for your sin, he also did for your sickness and disease. The chastisement of your peace was upon him, and by his stripes you were healed.
Come on.
So everything we have need of was provided for by what Jesus Christ bore upon himself. He bore it all for us. And if we do not walk in what he had given to us, we make what he did in vain. Am I right? I invite you. Say that everybody in this place is without a home, and you know, and nobody has any food. And so I go out and I buy a bunch of food and put it in the refrigerator, in the pantries. And I buy all this food. I had to work extra hours, had to do all kinds of things, but I provided all this food for you. And I come back and I look, and the refrigerator is still full. You didn't have to touch none of the food. You look in the pantry, you've not taken anything out of the pantry. I said, what have you guys been eating? Grass. Grass. Yeah, we've been eating some grass outside, you know. What are you doing eating grass? Why aren't you taking advantage of everything that I just gave you? See, what you've done was taking what I've given, and what I gave was in vain because you're not using it.
That's good.
If we don't take and receive all that Christ gave us, did for us, then what he did was for nothing. Amen.
Amen.
Boy, man, look, come on. You hurt me here. Wow.
Amen.
Oh. He endured all that for us so we don't have to take it. That we can be liberated from it. That we can be free from the power of sin today. Not just wait till we get to heaven.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Malcolm.
So not only do we have forgiveness of sins and everlasting life through what Christ accomplished, but we have freedom from the power of sin today.
Amen.
Praise God.
And it's all yours. Free for the receiving. Free for the taking.
Amen.
All you have to do is believe. Is that hard?
No.
It's simple, isn't it? But it's not easy, right? It's simple, but not easy. Why? Because we got this to deal with. But the Bible is clear in Romans 12. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye trans, or be ye, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Take what's inside your spirit and let it change you. Build that pathway. Build walk down that trail to the living waters and make a path. Walk in it, 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 and daily draw from it. And then you'll live a victorious Christian life. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Wow, not too bad. Now, let's talk about something else. No, don't just listen. So is anybody getting anything from this? Okay. I wanted to preach, but the Lord said teach. So I'm teaching. Verse 23 of Colossians 1. I'm going to back it up and read 22 again so we can get right back on step. Talk about it. We were alienated, enemies in God, without making wicked works, but we've been reconciled. In the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. Colon. There's something else that goes on here. Uh-oh. If you continue in the faith. So, I guess you can say that this position of holiness is contingent on something. Contingent on only one thing. Not in what you do. Not in how well you behave. Not in how well you do things. That was a hallelujah right there if I ever heard you. But if you continue in the faith, as long as you remain in Christ, remain in faith, trusting in what he has accomplished, you can rest assured that you will never lose this position in Christ. Amen. Never lose it.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. No matter how many times you mess up, no matter how many times you make a fool of yourself, right?
Right.
Why? Because you remain in the faith. There's a margin of error, I'm sure, you know. And look at me, if I can make it, you can make it, okay?
Amen.
Hey, you weren't supposed to say amen to that one.
Amen.
Yeah, glory, hallelujah. That works, man. So, anyway. But if you continue the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. I like to look at every word. Okay, I'm sorry, but you know, I just like to look at every word. See, if we remain in faith and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, what's the hope of the gospel? I just went over that most of the whole service, right? The hope of the gospel is we're right with God. Everything that Jesus Christ accomplished on that cross, through his sufferings, through what he went through, he bore for us that we can walk in total liberty. Over the world, the flesh, and the devil. Victory over that. You know, death, hell, and the grave. Victory over that. Right?
Amen.
So, the hope that we have, don't be moved away from that. Don't be discouraged. And we have so many people today that try to live perfect, try to, you know, well, you know, I tried to cross and it don't work. Well, first of all, your problem was you tried. You don't try the cross.
Yes.
You put faith in the cross.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
That's right.
If you try, it means you're under a system of works, and it's not going to work for you anyway.
No.
So, there's your problem right there.
Come on.
You know? Repent of it, go to the cross in faith, live. Now, it's interesting about the gospel. We don't have time to get into the first part of Colossians 1. But it says, about the gospel, what you have heard. This is getting to be old with these glasses, let me tell you right now. Which you've heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. In the first part, in verse 4 and 5, they were talking about, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love you have for all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. You see that? Which is coming to you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit. What's bringing fruit? The gospel. Since the day they heard it. Right? Because it goes on to say, since the day you heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. So the moment you that you hear the gospel, and the moment that it becomes truth to you, and the moment that you understand this, it begins to bear fruit in you. And if you remain rooted and grounded in this truth, by maintaining faith in what was accomplished for you, you will be established in the faith, and it'll be hard for you to be moved away from the hope of the gospel.
Amen.
But if you're moved away from the hope of the gospel, guess what you're putting your faith in? Law. Works. Regimens and programs.
Come on.
Okay, now, I want to shift gears completely. And let's make this practical. How, Dustin, do I do this? How do I live what you just talked about tonight? How do I put faith in the cross? How do I do it? It comes through maturity, experiential knowledge. It comes through messing up sometimes. Because look, listen, I've been here to this place where, you know, I know it's about faith, and I cry out to God, how much faith does it take? Because I'm operating in all the faith I got. I can't produce more faith than what I have. Can you? I mean, the amount of faith you have right now, can you just all of a sudden just say, oh, I'm going to have more faith tonight? No. But the more you read, or the more you put yourself in this truth, whether you hear it, whether you read it, whether you live it, whether you know, you follow what I'm saying? When you become engaged in this, and this becomes your life, and you, this is, and then all of a sudden, by the exercise of use, you become more mature in Christ. Your senses become, let me read it in Hebrews. Chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 13. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he's a babe. So, if you just sit here and listen, take notes, go home, and watch TV, you're just a babe. All you're doing is you're just using milk. And you're unskillful in the word of righteousness. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, mature, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. What does that mean? It means because you've applied yourself to this truth and allowed the Holy Spirit to work in you, and because you're putting in faith and you're trusting in what God's going to do, and you step out and you try to live this life, guess what's going to happen? You're going to get smacked in the face with trials and tribulations and hardships of every kind. And you're going to be wondering, oh man, why? Ever since I began to listen and begin to believe and put faith in this cross, my life has gotten more miserable. It's harder to live now. I mean, like every time I turn around, something's happening. I mean, there's just struggles after struggle after struggle. Well, you know what? You're being exercised. You're being trained. You're being tested so that your faith will be established.
Amen.
Amen. That you'll be complete and lacking nothing. And so you mature in Christ, and knowing what's right, what's of God, and what's not of God. How many of you, since you started listening and having faith in this message, you watch stuff on television and you go, that's not God. That's not God. Right. That's surely not God. Or you see something on Facebook and you go, what's that? And you write something on that and people text you back and who made you judge? Jesus Christ said, this is not, you know, whatever. Why? Because you've learned, you're growing in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord.
Praise God.
Amen.
And now you understand what's good and what's God and what's not God. That's progress. You're consistently drawing from the well. You're living victoriously in Christ, even though it might not seem like it. But you got to remember, the Holy Spirit's doing a progressive work in you, and He will complete it if you don't quit. If you don't give up and you don't quit, you'll see it.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.